Recently, the Japanese Slim mission landed on the moon's surface, adding Japan to the select list of countries that have successfully landed a spacecraft on the lunar surface. But why do different countries around the world suddenly have an interest in placing spacecraft on the surface of the moon? If in the 1960s, NASA managed to put astronauts on the lunar surface, why is it now so difficult to return? If you want to know the answer to all those questions, stay with us to find out. The first space race. As we all know, during the 1960s, NASA and the Soviet Union engaged in a technology race to prove to the world which of the two superpowers had the better technology. This competition led both nations to set ambitious goals, with the moon being one of those goals. This was the main reason why the US poured so much money into the Apollo program, and it was also the reason why the Soviet Union funded so many space projects such as the Mir space station. By the end of the 70s, both nations had achieved different goals in space technologies. The Soviet Union with the first man in space and NASA with the first man on the moon's surface. However, after achieving these goals, both nations had run out of budget to continue financing such costly projects. Sending humans to the moon was never an easy feat to achieve, let alone cheap. Today, allocating the amount of money to NASA during the space race would be unthinkable. As we mentioned in another video, the Apollo program to take astronauts to the lunar surface had more political than scientific goals, so there was no reason to continue sending humans to the moon once that goal was achieved. On the other hand, technologies began to become more and more efficient, and a space exploration probe could now execute the work that previously took a couple of astronauts. Technology replaced astronauts. During the space race, digital technology such as computers and robots was entirely new. The computers of the time were nothing like modern ones, therefore it was not feasible to send a fully automated spacecraft to land on the moon on its own. For reference, the computer-controlled Apollo 11 command module had 4 kilobytes of RAM and a 32 kilobyte ROM. If, as you've just heard, the computer in the spaceship that landed humans on the moon was 100,000 times slower than the phone you use every day. Just think that. Currently, RAM is several terabytes or hundreds of thousands of kilobytes. Because of this low computing power, it was unthinkable that a computer could perform such a complex task, such as landing on the moon on its own. That is why it was decided to take people, since a person could observe with their eyes the lunar terrain's geography and make real-time decisions about where would be the best place to land, something that a computer could not do, at least not at that time. Things have changed a lot since the 60s. Computers today are millions of times more potent than they were then, and a single computer can perform calculations so advanced and complex that they far exceeded the processing power of humans. Nowadays, computers can already do something unthinkable in the last century, like drive a car, land a plane, and of course, pilot a spaceship. Modern spacecraft have computers that allow them to perform much more precise maneuvers than if humans controlled them. Computers also have many advantages over humans, such as they don't need to rest, they don't need to eat, they are always alert, and they can perform complex calculations in a fraction of a second. They are not affected by the absence of gravity, the absence of a magnetic field. They do not suffer damage from the sun's radiation. They can stay asleep for a long time if necessary, such as when you take long journeys within the solar system. In many ways, computer-controlled spacecraft outperform humans, especially in space environments, as humans need a lot of resources to survive, but spacecrafts don't. You just need to give them some sunlight to capture that light with their solar panels and thus recharge their batteries. That's all they need. In contrast, humans need food, water, rest, and many other things. Space agencies today prefer sending uncrewed missions to study the solar system instead of sending real astronauts. In other words, we are in an age where automated uncrewed spacecrafts are far more efficient than a group of experienced astronauts. That's why NASA decided to send rovers to Mars instead of astronauts. That's why we send uncrewed missions to gaseous planets instead of astronauts. And that's why the first to land on the surface of a comet were space exploration probes and not astronauts. It is for this reason that space agencies send uncrewed spacecrafts to the moon instead of spacecraft with astronauts. Another reason why sending automated robotic probes to the moon is preferable is that they are much cheaper than a human-crewed spacecraft. Before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can improve them for you, the viewer. Plus, don't forget to subscribe to our channel by making sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our daily videos. A question of budget. Although many people have a hard time understanding it, one of the main reasons NASA stopped taking humans to the moon was the budget. Yes, money. Sending humans to another celestial body is not cheap. The Apollo program cost more than $25 billion at the time, equivalent to $100 billion today. The Apollo spacecraft alone cost nearly $8 billion, not counting the Saturn rocket that was used to send spacecraft, landers, or astronaut suits that cost more than $1 million each. In comparison, the Chandrayaan-3 spacecraft of the Indian Space Agency, which successfully landed on the lunar surface, cost only $74.6 million, 1,000 times cheaper than what the Apollo program cost. Clearly, sending autonomous spacecraft to the moon is much cheaper than sending astronauts. We are achieving the dream goal of sending human beings to the lunar surface, which requires not only humanity's greatest geniuses, but also the entire budget a nation could provide. But this could not be maintained forever. The annual budget of the United States began to fall short for this enormous undertaking. So in 1971, NASA received a budget cut that suddenly stopped all manned missions to the moon, and Apollo 17 was the last mission to take astronauts to the surface of our natural satellite. Since then, no human has set foot on the moon's surface again. Not for the lack of technology, but for lack of budget. As we have already seen, sending humans to the moon is not something that all space agencies worldwide can afford, since it requires a lot of money. But on top of that, from the last astronauts to go to the moon in 1971 to the year 2000, there was no genuine interest in returning to the moon, as there was no knowledge that there was anything of value there. This is analogous to the voyages made by explorers of the European era of exploration, such as Ferdinand Magellan or Christopher Columbus. During their travels worldwide, these travelers found new places and unexplored territories. What if those places had nothing of value, they simply overlooked them and continued their journey? For example, if the places they discovered were desert landscapes without any wealth or strategic geographical position, it was not even worth returning there because there would be no reward. Conversely, if the places they found were filled with riches such as rare metals, precious stones, or exotic fruits and spices, they had excellent reason to establish a colony and return as many times as necessary. There were excellent reasons to have a constant presence in that place. Similarly, when the astronauts of the Apollo missions went to the moon, they brought back samples of lunar rocks and dust that showed that the moon was a desert landscape without any form of life. The photographs taken from the orbiting module showed no signs of water either. So for many years, politicians came to the consensus that it was not worth returning to the moon because there was nothing of value there. However, many scientists were of the opposite opinion. This idea prevailed for several decades, and the rest of the world's nations knew it was not worth investing so much money in a place with nothing to offer us. Even though the nations had no reason to return to the moon, the scientific community continued to insist that going to the moon was not a waste of time and money. On the contrary, they insisted that on the moon there were precious resources worth returning for. What were those resources? What could be on the moon that would be so important as to return after more than 50 years? The new gold rush. After the Apollo 17 mission, the last spacecraft to take humans to the moon's surface, scientists on Earth analyzed all the samples of lunar dust and rocks that astronauts had brought back and discovered something that left them dumbfounded. The Apollo 17 mission stood out for many things. One of them was that it was the only mission that carried a scientist. Do you mean that the other Apollo missions didn't carry scientists? That's right. As we mentioned at the beginning of the video, the trip to the moon had a more political than scientific purpose. So the first Apollo missions were led mainly by military personnel, soldiers, or Air Force pilots. However, after many complaints from the scientific community, NASA and the US government finally gave in to requests to take at least one scientist on their last mission of the Apollo program. The one chosen for this mission would ultimately be geologist Harrison Hagen Schmidt, an experienced geologist who would bring back the most valuable rock samples. In the samples brought back from the moon by Harrison, molecules of precious material such as titanium, silicon, aluminum, and helium-3 molecules were discovered. These materials are scarce and difficult to obtain on Earth because they are usually found in mines mixed with other less valuable materials. Hence, their extraction and collection are complicated and expensive. But on the Moon, they are naturally scattered on the surface, so they would be much easier to extract and take advantage of than on Earth. These discoveries went unnoticed for many years because although there were many valuable materials on the Moon, there was no way to establish a base there to take advantage of them. After all, although the rock samples brought back by Harrison also found traces of water molecules, this would not be enough to supply the needs of a lunar base. But this changed in the new millennium. During the 2000s, different projects were launched for the study of the Moon, with telescopes and exploration probes. Some of them were the LCROSS satellite, the acronym for Lunar Crater Observation and Sensing Satellite, and the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, LRO, space probe. These two space probes confirmed what scientists had suspected for decades: the Moon has water. Although it is not water in a liquid state as on Earth, it is frozen water underneath the surface of some areas of the Moon, especially the South Pole craters, where solar radiation does not reach. With the confirmation of the existence of water on the Moon, the nations of the world now see the possibility of being able to establish a permanent settlement of humans on the Moon to take advantage of its resources with a new era of lunar mining, in which we would extract the resources of the Moon and bring them to Earth. This gives rise to the new space race, which, unlike the space race of the 1960s, is going to have an economic purpose, since the resources and metals that are used for modern technologies such as solar panels, smartphones, computers, tablets, among other technologies, are beginning to become scarce on Earth, but they are very abundant on the Moon. For example, helium-3 deposited in lunar regolith is a material that does not exist on Earth and can be used as fuel for space rockets and energy production by nuclear fission reactors. Undoubtedly, the Moon has an immense amount of resources, which is why in the new space race of the 21st century, all the world's nations will seek to get a piece of the lunar cake. But the scientific community has an important question. In our eagerness to take advantage of lunar resources, won't we end up causing damage to our natural satellite, just as we've harmed our planet by destroying nature to extract the resources we want? Your opinion is always the most important thing to us, so let us know what you think. Do you think the new era of lunar mining will be to take advantage of the Moon's resources, or on the contrary, we will only destroy the surface of the Moon? Let us know what you think in the comments.